everyone this afternoon. Welcome to the City Council meeting. I do want to remind you that this is our workshop meeting during which we'll be discussing all of our agenda items, and we do have agendas back here on the podium if you'd like to pick one up and follow along with us. We won't be voting tonight, however. This is just for discussion. We are going to start, instead of starting with our public hearings, we're actually going to start under the old business section of our agenda, which starts up with the review of requests for proposals received for banking services, and then we'll come back and pick up the public hearing at 6 p.m., the time for the public hearing. Is that correct?
Is it 1 minute, Mayor?
Hold on just a moment.
Before we go into the meeting, we have one public hearing. This has been set for 5:30.
Okay.
Which is for the council to hear any public comment on the proposed FY 2019 proposed budget. So I'll open this up for a public hearing. We have the FY 2019 proposed budget that has been submitted by staff to council. I think it's been out for available for y'all to view. Is there anyone here that would like to make a public comment concerning the FY 19 proposed budget for the City of Tifton? There I see no public comment. I'd ask that public hearing be closed.
Okay.
And again, we would ask that the other public hearings be postponed
until 6 p.m. Exactly. Okay. And thank you for your patience in working with us to get to that 6 p.m. time frame. So we'll start our meeting off with the request for proposals received for banking services. And Wayne, I believe you've got some updated information. If you'd like to come forward and share that with us, please, sir.
Madam Mayor and distinguished gentlemen of the council, I had sent two things out to y'all via email regarding the results from our RFP for banking services. The first one I'll go over real slowly was the first one via email. It was an Excel sheet that kind of broke down some of the high points of the RFP things between the four banks that sent us proposals: Synovus, Ameris, BB&T, and SunTrust. The biggest thing that was brought to my attention was interesting. One was the interest rate on available funds. Difference there, Synovus had quotas 0.30%, Ameris 0.80%, BB&T 0.60% on available money. On our banking fees, in our things, and in the bank fees, Synovus waives theirs, BB&T waives theirs. In the report we got from Ameris, it said that they calculated monthly, and what it stated was potentially waived if compensating balance hanged each month. I'll talk about SunTrust later. Online banking, we looked at the interface. All three of them had internet banking. We rely heavily on our internet banking, moving money back and forth between accounts, between our savings and our operating and disbursement accounts. In the thing, both Synovus and BB&T stated they use 128-bit encryption on their stuff. That is our IT department's thing, but under the Ameris thing, it did not mention what type of encryption level they used. Also on that is that we have a security token, which is an additional layer of service. BB&T has it. It didn't state it in Synovus, but we do have a token with Synovus because we currently use Synovus. It was not mentioned in Ameris thing.
Wayne, can I ask you a question?
Yes.
And you may or may not know, aren't the banks required to have a minimum encryption for protection of any customers? Isn't there a minimum standard for that?
There may be one, but I do not know what it is.
Okay.
So, I mean, so we ask, do you have the...
They have 125, whatever, they have the same encryption level as Synovus has, yeah.
So is there a minimum? I guess I could ask.
Colonies is the same thing. As far as the token is concerned, I'm 99.9% sure. I mean, we offer a token. I'm sure Ameris offers a token. Synovus offers a token. It's just
So those are all kind of standard basis for, okay, I just wanted to be clear, okay.
When you looked at local government customers, what was given to us, Synovus has TIF Regional Medical Center, ABAC, and TIF County as their three of their, what they provided. BB&T provided TIF County Board of Education, Brunswick, Glenn County Water, Joint Water, and City of Statesboro. Marist provided Doherty County School System, Glenn County, and the City of Pooler. When we asked that question, we asked them to try to have customers within like 100 miles of us. And I find it kind of odd that Marist did not include the City of Moultrie and Cauquia County as some of theirs, two of their customers.
But they are your customers.
Yes. Next thing is we're looking to try to do more using a purchase card or what they call a P-card system or a credit card thing to help with cash flows better. All three offer credit cards. BB&T offers a purchase card. They're the only one of the three that offers a purchase card. The purchase card actually provides us with more controls and better use and be able to float, cash float, what we our bills longer than the other two. The other thing that is the Marist credit card, theirs is coming through a third party. It's not the bank, it's a third party, which is a company called Elan. For just using the purchase card through BB&T, you can earn rebate money every year. BB&T purchase card used to be actually, until about 2 years ago, was the one the state used for their purchase card program through the Department of Administrative Services. And they switched over to Bank of America a couple of years ago. Local business using car, I know TIF County uses Synovus. From knowing the former finance director over there. TIF County Board of Education uses the purchase card program. So those are the two I know local there's using those things at this point in time. In the second email when I sent, or memo I sent out, I went a little bit farther in depth of all the things. Most all the banks pretty much meet pretty our minimum requirements. I mean, they're all full service home, maintain a full service home office here in the city of Tifton. They're all federally state chartered. There is no intermediary bank services they go through. They all have the online thing. They all have experience with similar customers. It seems some have more experience than others. They all have served customers using direct deposit. And we did ask for set deposits up to 5 p.m. and credit accounts that day. That's pretty close there. Other things we asked and talked about that was in RFP, we asked about lockbox services, statement and frequency and reporting, banking supplies, bank fees, collateral, remote deposit capture, cash vault, wire transfers, and then on top of that, the credit or slash purchase cards. We looked as these as a whole, not just one particular item, what we thought was best for the city and our department. When we first looked at the things, the SunTrust proposal was removed because they did not state a lot of the questions we asked. So we had no way of knowing what they did or not. It looked like a stock just proposal they stuck out there and they didn't answer a lot of the questions we requested. So we took them out of consideration. So it left down to Marist, SunTrust, and Synovus. Well, not SunTrust, BB&T and Synovus, excuse me. Yes, we've gone over the interest rates. That was one thing. We know bank up front were waived by two of the banks.
I see they say those who waived them verbally.
Did you ask? They actually told us up front that they would waive it.
But is it in their RFP?
The RFP, they didn't state that, but they told me, because it was, when they handed me the thing, says we waive our fees, period.
But if it's not in work, if it's not, I don't see how we can, Rob, you tell me, if it's not in their RFP that they are waiving their fees and it is a verbal statement, but in their account analysis on their, in their packet, they show significant amounts of money that need to be in the, held as deposits to waive, to offset those fees versus Ameris's accounts. Do we need to go by what is included in their RFP or what has been said over the phone to a person that could or could not?
Yeah, it wasn't over the phone, it was face-to-face on those.
Face-to-face. Would we need to go by what is included in the RFP?
Yes.
Okay.
So is there any difference as far as the RFPs between the three?
Yes.
No, on that case, no.
In that case, they're all, they all say they may waive.
That's correct.
That's not to say that if you have those RFPs that you still can negotiate.
Right. But that takes that, so that's no longer something based on that statement. They're all equal.
In that case,
well,
yes.
Yeah, from the analysis standpoint.
But
I mean, because
one of the hits on Ameris was they weren't going to waive and the other two would.
Right.
This sounds like the RFPs are all the same.
The RFP, the actual, what was presented to them and handed in their packet was X amount of dollars being held in an account, monthly average balance would offset X amount of dollars in fees. Synovus's requirements for deposits were significantly more than Ameris's requirements, and the fees, if those deposits were not there, were significantly more than what Ameris's was. Based on the RFPs themselves, that's why I made ask the question. As a verbal statement, so if I came to you and I said, "Hey, my RFP says I got 0.38%, but we'll give you 0.95," which, you know, I mean, I
think if it's, you know, there's nothing that prohibits, you know, negotiations after you receive the RFPs, but I think that it should be equal. And so, if somebody says, "I'm willing to do this," then I think it should be something that's submitted to us in writing. And then I think to be fair, you know, let the other, you know, bidders know that this was a proposal. What are you willing to do? And then, you know, but again, everything needs to be in writing.
Right. In writing, that's right. That's right.
So we could go back then, based on what you're saying, we could go back to everyone who submitted a proposal, say, this is the proposal we got from everybody. And we need you to basically submit your best proposal.
Well, they've
saying?
Already done that.
You're saying others have said they'll waive the fees. We'll
right.
waive the fees.
Okay.
Well, I mean, that's what we've already done. We've already asked you to put your best foot forward.
Well,
that's what I'm saying, but
we don't have. Okay, so we're not getting another RFP. We're just negotiating on what we've received.
That's correct.
Okay.
And so, I mean, City Council certainly has the option to, you know, not accept any of the bids accept the bids or negotiate the bids.
Right. And also, it's understood by all the parties that a full relationship, I guess less credit cards, I guess that wouldn't matter, but we wouldn't keep operating account here and then a couple of deposit accounts over in this bank. I mean, it would be a full relationship.
It depends. My original proposal was that the savings stuff stay at BB&T, and when we utilize it, keep it there so we can utilize their purchase card program and then leave the operations at Synovus.
Mm-hmm.
Is that your current recommendation?
Yes.
Okay.
If y'all would like something, if y'all want us to do something different, that's the City Council's.
But the RFP, so all three knew that they were only going to get the operating.
Well, originally we thought, when I looked at it, it was going to be all together, but not all of them. There wasn't one that, in my opinion, took care of everything. Now, if you want me to go do all in, my recommendation would be BB&T altogether.
Take you talking about the card, the purchasing card.
Well, it's all of it. It's the purchasing card, it's the online banking, it's the interest, waiving of the fee. It's not just one thing. It's looking at as a whole, plus what we use online and the easy use from our staff to make sure things get done properly.
But let me rephrase that. If we, the P card can go to BB&T, okay. Would it be a surprise, and with it the associated savings accounts, I guess, or the, you know, would it be a surprise to Synovus and Ameris that if they're not getting the P card, that they're only going to get the operating account? Do you think that would change
No, because right now, most of all of our savings are at BB&T. That's where most all of our money is right now. Synovus has been waiving their thing, and we usually keep maybe $500,000 there across all of our accounts that are at Synovus. We've got over $19 million at BB&T right now.
So you believe that if you went back to either Ameris or Synovus, and the P-card and the savings associated are going to stay there, and we're going to give you operating, that they wouldn't have a problem?
They probably would have a problem. I don't think Synovus would, because Synovus is it wouldn't be any change from the way it is right now. But I don't know if Ameris would change or not, because this is a different, now it's just the operating accounts. That's from our current things are right now compared to changing.
Well, I mean, my understanding was the reasoning for the RFP was to find, first of all, making sure all of our people are honest and you know, keeping everybody honest.
Yeah.
Giving their best option to us, our best interest rates. All right. And we've done that. You know, implementing any bank service, obviously with this large of an account, they're going to roll out the red carpet. So if Ameris, I know in your summary here, you say that Ameris says and it's that's going to be 120 days to implement.
Up to 120 days. That
I'm
was
sure
in
that
there.
They will, I don't know. I mean, they could be 120 days, but I think that they would put, I mean, when you have a $15 to $20 million deposit relationship coming to your bank, you roll out every red carpet and have every balloon full of helium that makes it, I mean, you're going to be top priority.
And you're saying, Rob, that we can do that because the RFP's already been submitted, that we can go back and negotiate.
I've not seen the RFP, but I think from what I hear, the point that may be made is that were they given the options? Could you, you know, we take our operating account, and if you do take our operating account,
they were not.
Because I think that I can see where that may have an effect on their bid, depending on whether they got the whole package.
Does it set precedent, basically a bad precedent? Because if we were to say we were to do, when the chief presents a bid for a vehicle going forward, do we need to then go back and say, okay, hey guys, well, we got a real good bid from these guys. Can you match this bid or whatever?
That's not what was said. What was said was the verbal, when they were handed it, it was something verbal. To be fair to Ameris in this case, it could have been either one of them. If the other two came and handed it and said verbally, we're going to waive the fees.
Well,
now, I think you can go to Ameris and say, hey, these other two handed it to me and said we waive the fees. Will you waive them too? That gives them the fair option, and everybody's on level playing field.
A good example is when we bid out the garbage collection. You know, there's various options. You know, if you do yard debris, if you do white goods, if you do just garbage pickup and what have you. So they were given an option to bid on different ways. And so I am a little bit uncomfortable.
I almost wonder if it wouldn't be better just to reject the RFPs and start over. I don't know how much trouble that creates, but you're looking at me like, I know you didn't just say that.
And Wayne and Karen have done extremely a massive amount of work on this. Mm-hmm. And it's very detailed when you talk about that much money, you talk about accounts.
Yeah.
We have to use the best service, number one, but operationally,
sure.
You know, how many facets go along with that, it's very difficult to, you know, to go right into that small pen.
But the problem is, you know, when you, and I realize you're looking at the whole proposal, but when you're going to take somebody that's 0.3% over somebody that's 0.8%, and I read through some of the reasons, whereas I can really appreciate that I take internal control seriously, there's nothing been more important to me in 30 years, as you know. We should ask some questions. If one mentioned something about large ACH and wire transactions and stuff and didn't mention it, well, it doesn't hurt to ask the question about that and say, what about these, to allay any concerns you have over internal controls. I mean, I would be shocked that Ameris didn't have as good internal controls as Synovus and BB&T.
Are they a multi-billion dollar bank? I'm pretty sure they're all the same.
You know, so, and I can appreciate that the contacts have more banking experience. Well, if those two contacts could leave tomorrow and you're left with, you know, with two that don't have as much, you know, thing. So I see some of these, but I can't get past the 0.3% and the 0.8%. That is a huge difference to me.
So what do we need to do moving forward to be able to, I guess you're saying, leave the proposals on the table, but really evaluate them fairly across the board so that everybody has the same consideration that will satisfy the council?
Well, Jessica had a good point. I mean, request for proposal is not a bid.
Yeah.
And what you're doing is receiving proposals from various entities and then seeing, you know, who you can get the best deal from. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I don't have a problem with where we are now. I think it might have been, you know, we can just go to these people who present the proposals and say, council has been, you know, making some inquiries, what if this, what if that, what will you be able to do? And then, you know, nail down what ultimately is their best proposal.
Yeah, I mean, we don't want to give up the verbal commitment they made of no fees.
Right.
I want to go up as an RFP. I want no fees. I also want no fees from Ameris. You know?
Like I have that writing, though.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. I mean, that's what you gotta have.
But I don't want to go to the RFP because it's worse than what the verbal thing was. So you go to Ameris and say, well, you waive the fees too, just like the other two.
Okay,
I suspect they'd probably say yes.
Are we in consensus? Probably what we need to do so we can move on is let's if you can, if each council member, let me just throw this out there and see if this is okay. If each council member could address in an email to Pete what their concerns are, what do you want, no fees, you want, you know, certain, whatever it is, and let's get that to Pete, and then you and Wayne evaluate and
sure.
See how we can go back to the table.
We could have a point of clarifications with exacts, with all the bidders.
That's acceptable to everybody to
sure.
Handle that.
I do want this to be brought back up to council. I don't want it because the option that's on the table is to remain the same. If we got an RFP that's on the table, that's pretty good. But now we're having to go back and look
well,
at
one
this
of the
stuff.
Things an RFP said we couldn't use third party credit card, third party stuff
that.
On that
now,
part.
Listen,
so that part we could not use.
Credit cards aren't an issue.
Credit cards are not an issue at all. We can go with BB&T tomorrow if you want to make that recommendation.
Is that something you think we can have by our June 18th meeting? Or is that too, or should we workshop for the July workshop?
Let's do it for
June 18th.
Okay. Money on the
table. Okay. So everybody will email their concerns to you, Pete. You get with Wayne, and then we'll go from there. Is everybody good with that? Does that sound acceptable? Okay, thank you. All right, for those of you who are waiting on our public hearing, we just have 6 more minutes to go until we get to 6 o'clock. The next item on our agenda is review of the proposed municipal court judge service agreement. Pete, you want to go over that?
I will, thank you. We talked in our budget work session about the judge's contract. We did talk about it last year. A sample which I provided to you was, I sent that to Chad last week. He and I talked on the telephone. We had a brief conversation. He was going to write it up and add his comments. I did not get that back until just a little while ago. So if I could just call your attention to the third page, I'm going to work through this with him, but I want to ask your opinion. The third page, when you're talking about training, I really think we need to limit the dollar amount or the training options for the judge. That's probably very specialized once, twice a year, but obviously if it's in the contract, we've got to be a little more specified, and I can work that out with him. I do not think we need a method of timekeeping. We just put that in there that it's a flat rate of $32,959.
Okay.
I would also probably recommend number 6, benefits, to take that out. Just don't see benefits in this type of contract being eligible for this scenario. And then the term of agreement, it says that it ends June 30th, 2019, but if I recall right, if you turn the page, the termination, I think this OCGA section 36-32 allows, there's been some change with judgeships that says really judges can't be removed once they're appointed, if I'm correct.
I think that's right.
So really, the termination, here we go, we put termination dates in there, but they, per law, the judge is appointed, they're appointed unless they do something
crazy. So we will treat him as an independent contractor?
yes, I mean, those type of benefits, you have retirement, sick leave, you know, regular benefits, that certainly be part of it.
I'm saying no benefits, just an independent contractor, you're paying the flat 32 and.
$10.99.
And you're done, I don't pay any benefits, I don't pay any pension, I don't pay, I mean, I don't pay social security. I mean, this is his full-time job, this is a.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I'm saying there is some significant time, I'm sure, that is dedicated to this, because I mean, he has, I would hope that he reviews the cases.
That's what you're paying at $32,959.
For the service, so we could do an independent contract, that's.
I mean, if we had to, yeah, I mean, okay.
Maybe if you bump that a little bit.
Yeah, that's what I was gonna say.
To your point.
Yeah.
Okay. I could do that other, if there's anything else.
Well, just one point, just, you know, on the compensation for professional training, all the lawyers have to, you know, do so many hours a year, and, you know, certainly when he does judicial training, he's getting his hours required by the Georgia Bar.
Sure.
So, you know, I don't know if that's something that needs to be compensated for, frankly. Because he's gotta do it anyway. I just thought I'd throw that out for.
I agree with Rob.
I think we're nitpicking at that one.
Well, I just gotta do it anyway, why don't we push your table?
I'll pick this back up, Chad, just make all the revisions and have it for you.
Okay, and then present that back to us.
Make the decision regularly.
All right, thank you. Any other questions regarding that contract with the municipal court judge? All right, the next item is our review of the jail inmate agreement, that is Chief Dowdy and Pete.
Okay, that's probably gonna take more than 3 minutes, but we're sure.
We are,
Try it.
5:58, so do you want to, is there something else that you could do very quickly, we could shift around, or we can.
Resolution, Rock the Block.
Let's do that, let's do the resolution for Rock the Block. Let's go and get that out of the way, that'll take about 2 minutes, and then we'll come back, we'll just shift around. Jessica, do you wanna talk about Rock the Block, or you want me to, what you wanna do?
Can.
Okay. Well, on June the 30th, we're gonna have a Rock the Block out front, OMG has scheduled that, we've been meeting. We've got the band booked, we've got vendors, it's the traditional Rock the Block setup, but we need to create that as a festival area per our hospitality ordinance so that we can allow the restaurants and bars to use the special cups. That's been working well with our other events, so if there's any questions or anything, I'd be glad to answer those, but we'll just need to designate that as a festival area. So, any questions?
Nope.
Easy. All right, is it 6 o'clock? It's 5:59. Should talk slower.
6 o'clock.
6 o'clock. Oh, 6 o'clock. All right. Let's go ahead and start this meeting.
I'll go ahead and open the public meeting, so
yes.
Please report.
First of all, I'd like everybody to know the City of Tipton's written public hearing procedures, the City of Tipton's standards for exercising zoning powers, and the Council of Georgia conflict of laws are available to hand out and post in the public review. The first matter we have under consideration tonight is application number PP18-0027, made by Michael Bowen on behalf of the Board of Regents of the University System of Georgia to rezone 12.19 acres of land located at the intersection of US Highway 41 and Interstate I-75 from its current classification as residential professional to general business.
This time I'd like to ask about the conflict questions of counsel. Have any of these applicants or opponents of the application contributed at least $250 to any of the campaigns for election during the past 2 years?
No.
Do you or any members of your family have a property interest that would be affected by the proposed rezoning or reclassification of the property, whether it be a positive or negative impact?
No.
Do you or any members of your family have a financial interest in any business entity that has a property interest in any real property that would be affected by the proposed rezoning or reclassification of the property, whether it be a positive or negative impact?
No.
Okay. Prior to taking a public comment, I'm gonna ask Mr. Wallace to come up and explain to the council exactly what this reclassification constitutes.
Madam Mayor, Council. As Rob stated, it's approximately 12.19 acres. The agents are looking to redevelop this into general business. They already have a proposed development. Do y'all have any questions, comments, or concerns?
Danny, was this taken before the planning zoning commission?
Yes, yes, I'm sorry.
That's all right. What was their recommendation?
Their recommendation was to approve this. It was voted on, 2-1 vote, one turning down.
And as far as the staff recommendation?
The staff recommends that this be approved, council.
And what was the reason given for the one that turned it down?
Traffic.
Traffic?
There's concerns that that'd be a congested area because of the school. Fullwood Road.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Is it?
All right, at this time, I'll ask for any public input. Is there anyone here that would like to speak in favor of the application? Is there anyone here that would like to?
Which one of y'all?
Well, you're really welcome. Okay, why don't you come up and tell us what you're all about, okay?
Sure. We want to see those pretty boards that you brought.
Yeah.
We don't want you to tell those things to nothing. If you would, just state your name and your address.
Sure. John Bowen, 808 Ridge Avenue North, Tipton, Georgia. Like to speak on behalf of the development team who is seated behind me, the Bowen family, 31 North Real Estate Investors. And we just appreciate the opportunity to formally introduce this proposed project to the city and to our fellow citizens. Thank you. It's 12.19 acres. It's owned currently by the University of Georgia Board of Regents. There is interest on behalf of that party in seeing this site developed such that it would not only bolster the growth of that side of town, providing more resources, more amenities for all the university assets on that side of town, but just as an opportunity to serve the conference center. What we have proposed is anchored by a six-story select service hotel that is anchored in the middle by a pedestrian-only Main Street feature with bandstand, greenhouse, water feature. And the idea is just to create a holistic neighborhood environment on this site. It would include retail operations, gas operations, feature restaurants. We've got what we're calling a pup and people park. It would be a destination for local residents as well as travelers. But I think I would just comment by saying we're lifelong Tiptonites and we're invested in the healthy growth and development of our community. And we see this as a development that is faithful to that ambition and just appreciate the consideration of the council and our fellow citizens.
Any questions, gentlemen?
Is there anyone else that would like to speak in favor of the application? Is there anyone here that would like to speak in opposition to this application?
No, Council, there's been no further public comment. I ask that this public hearing be closed.
Okay. Oh, no, how about stop it? Stop it. Stop it.
It takes care of our dog park problem. I don't pick on just you, Wayne. I'm a full service business.
I'm sorry, they're making fun because I want a dog park and they don't. And you've got a pup and people park, which I appreciate. Thank you very much because it's someone who travels with her animals.
And we appreciate it. Now she'll be quiet about those. Very impressive.
Very. Johnny Terrell, don't make me tell him, make me come out there.
See Johnny on our side.
Yeah, was like Johnny tell us.
I said word.
Is there any other comments from council?
Do y'all have any questions or comments? I think we're good. This is the yes.
Yeah, Mayor Council, I will tell you just personally, I want to thank the Bowens for being able to be next to the inception of this and working through the details. Danny has helped out tremendously with this and going, just trying to look, you know, a little into the future. This is really an exciting project for Tipton and what it could offer. So thank you for your intensity and seeing it through. So we're not done yet. We're still working on a few things, but this is certainly the start of a great project.
Okay. Just know any way that we can be of assistance, we are proud to do so.
And this public hearing is closed.
Yes.
The next public hearing we're going to have tonight is application number PP1A0029. It's made on behalf of the city of Tifton to rezone 0.52 acres of land located at the intersection of U.S. Highway 41, being the parcel where the Waffle House is currently located, from its current classification as neighborhood commercial to general business. Again, I'd like to ask a conflict question to counsel. Have any of these applicants or opponents of the application contributed at least $250 to the campaigns for election in the past 2 years?
No.
Do you or any members of your family have a property interest that would be affected by the proposed rezoning and reclassification of property, whether it be a positive or negative impact?
No.
Do you or any members of your family have a financial interest in any business entity that has a property interest in any real property that would be affected by the proposed rezoning and reclassification of the property, whether it be a positive or negative impact?
No.
Okay, why don't you come on up? Mayor Council, I think maybe for time's sake, and we will go through the other public hearings on the other matters, but there's several other requests by the city to reclassify from neighborhood commercial general business the property located at the Affinity Healthcare, as well as the Harvey Shopping Center. So I thought maybe Danny could go ahead and address what those rezoning requests are, and then you won't have to keep coming up and
sure.
talking about
that's,
it.
That's fine, if that's okay with council. Yep. Go ahead, Danny.
All right, once again, the city is making this request. We are requesting to reclassify approximately 1 acre. It's known as the Waffle House. This will be a change in zoning. The zoning will not adversely affect any of the existing uses or usability of any of the adjacent properties. The property is owned by Tifton Professional Buildings, also known as the Waffle House Capital LLC. The property has been developed and is currently a location of the restaurant. The Tift County Tax Assessor's Office has no other records for this property. This property is located in the interchange area of our character map. This did go to planning and zoning on May the 14th and was approved unanimously. And our recommendation, of course, is to approve it.
What was the purpose for the change in zoning? Was it just to clean up zoning in that area? Is that all this was?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Our character map for our comprehensive plan, it's so we can be proactive for developers. Take it the way it's a little bit easier for us to go through the process than it is a developer.
I understand. So it's just anticipating future development and we'll be ready for general business.
That's correct.
Is there any impact that this is going to have on the neighborhood from Emmett Drive? What direction is that? East.
No.
Okay.
Not at this time.
That's your district.
Yeah. Maybe I should know, but I don't. The difference between neighborhood commercial and general business, what can now be allowed in general business that's not allowed in neighborhood commercial?
There are some things that are allowed that aren't allowed in neighborhood commercial, but it's mostly zoning and about the permeable area, what can be covered with asphalt and what can't. And the areas for setbacks and buffers. This actually, if these properties, the hospital property, which was just done, if it would have been zoned general business, they would have been required to have a larger buffer, which would have actually been a little bit more beneficial for the neighborhood.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I have called grief over that. I'm waiting for that buffer that they promised to put in there, and I don't see it.
It's coming.
Oh, it's
they're yes, sir. They're getting very close to being done with that project.
Well, that's what worries me. I haven't seen the buffer or any place it could be planted.
Well, they won't get their final paperwork without it.
Okay. So yes, should the people that live on Emmett be worried
about
that this is now general business? Rob, you're a block from that. Are you worried that this is now general business versus neighborhood commercial?
No, I mean, because what we're dealing with, what's existing is what we're going to have to deal with in the future. The affinity is already there.
Yeah.
Of course, the zoning did not apply to the hospital, so they could pretty much do what they wanted to do.
That's true.
And as far as the Harvey Shopping Center, naturally, that's already there and developed. The Waffle House is already there and developed. And so really, you really have general, what I would think is general business. Business is already there.
Okay, let's go a step further. Say Harvey's closes, and you know, there's only little bits and pieces in that other piece, and they just wipe the whole thing out. What then can be built there that can't be built now? What, I mean, that's, I'm trying to think what this open, I mean, general business is a little more.
It's a little, you know, denser, yes, sir.
Than neighborhood commercial, right?
That's correct. It is.
So just because Harvey's is there now, doesn't mean Harvey's going to be there 5 years from now. And that shopping center might not be there 5 years from now. And we're, you know, half a block from houses.
If I recall the map correctly, then you can correct me if I'm wrong, but basically you have general business kind of scattered around that area.
That's correct.
And it is a little bit out of, it is a little bit out of sync with what's there in the surrounding areas. Mm-hmm. And so that's one of the things when we looked at the map, considering this, it did look like it was consistent, general business would have been consistent with other properties in that area. So that was one of the thoughts.
That makes sense. If it's just sort of cleaning things up, so that it's, you know, so that it's still palatable for commercial development, which is obviously what's going to be there. But if the general business zoning is more restrictive from a buffer protecting the neighborhood.
Correct.
My understanding of neighborhood commercial is that you've got this sort of mix of homes and commercial properties and stuff, but with general business, it's very defined. Is that a fair statement?
That is correct.
Okay.
Neighborhood commercial is your professional offices, and grocery stores are allowed in there. That's the reason why it was developed in that manner.
Okay.
The property just north of the hospital, that's all general business. Everything on the east side or the west side of I-75 is general business. Except for, of course, where UGA is. And then the rest of the buffer, sir.
All right, well, I'm really not worried about across, you know,
yes, sir.
At this point, across the interstate, though, Emmett people don't care about that. But north of there is those apartments.
That's correct. It's general business.
There's no other.
That's zone general business.
Right.
What we need to do is just
it's a risk if they tear all the apartments down and build something there.
Yeah.
I don't think that's
well,
gonna
I think
what
well, we
what
need.
What about that apartment next to it?
What about what?
It's not.
What'd you say, Wes?
Is it a vacant lot next to that apartment complex?
I think what we need to do is just make sure that we protect Emmett Drive East with, even if it's something we need to do on rights of way with buffers and making sure that we, you know, don't disrupt that residential neighborhood any more than it's already been disrupted, you know. So I think that's the concern is you know, for that.
This is a city request, is that right?
That's correct.
Okay.
As it stands right now, it's okay.
Mm-hmm.
But just
what happens 25 years from now, or 2 years from now, yeah.
There are other tools. The buffers, it would have been more beneficial to y'all.
Right. Okay. And we just need to make sure
if
that
it was already zoned general business.
Commercial?
We couldn't stop the hospital anyway.
That's true.
The hospital was going to do.
They'll work with me, though.
Well, I know, but we, it did not matter what we zone, the hospital doesn't have to follow.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. All right, any other questions on this city requested rezoning?
No.
Change? Okay.
This was regarding the public hearing on the Waffle House property. Is there anyone here that wants to speak to favor the application of Mr. Walsh? Is there anyone here that would like to speak in opposition to that rezoning of the Waffle House property? Your Honor, should that public hearing be closed?
Okay.
This time I'm going to open a public hearing on application number PP 180030. also made by the City of Tifton. We zone 11.53 acres of land located 2225 and 2227 U.S. Highway 41. This is the Affinity Healthcare Facilities from its current classification as neighborhood commercial to general business. I'll ask the Council the conflict questions. Have any of these applicants or opponents to the application contributed at least $250 saying the campaign for election during the past 2 years?
No.
No.
Do you or any members of your family have a property interest that would be affected by the proposed rezoning or reclassification of the property, whether it be a positive or negative impact?
No.
No.
Do you or any members of your family have financial interest in any business entity that has a property interest in any real property that would be affected by the proposed rezoning or reclassification of the property, whether it be a positive or negative impact?
No.
Again, this is an application that's been brought by the City of Tifton to reclassify from resident, I'm sorry, from general business, from residential professional to general business, I'm sorry, neighborhood commercial general business. Is there anyone here who would like to speak in favor of the application? Is there anyone here who would like to speak in opposition to the application? Mayor, there being no further public comment, I'd ask that that public hearing be closed.
Okay.
The next public hearing is going to be on application number PP180032, made by the City of Tifton to rezone 4.4 acres of land located 2201 U.S. Highway 41 North, which is located at the shopping center where the Harvey's grocery store is located, from its current classification as neighborhood commercial to general business. Again, I'd like to ask the conflict questions of council. Have any of these applicants or opponents to the application contributed at least $250 to any of the campaigns for election during the past 2 years?
No.
Do you or any members of your family have a property interest that would be affected by the proposed rezoning or reclassification of the property, whether it be a positive or negative impact?
No.
Do you or members of your family have a financial interest in any business entity that has a property interest in a real property that would be affected by the proposed rezoning or reclassification of the property, whether it be a positive or negative impact?
No.
This time I open this up for public comment. Is there anyone here that would like to speak in favor of the application? Is anyone here that would like to speak in opposition to the reclassification? There will be no further public comment. I would ask that public hearing be closed.
Okay. Thank you, Rob.
And then I think that completes our public hearing.
Okay. All right. You are certainly welcome to stay and enjoy this plethora of intelligent discussion, but we certainly understand if you don't want to. So thank you to the Bowens for being here this evening. Appreciate very much what you're doing. All right, we will now pick back up with where we are in our order of the agenda. We are on item number 8 under new business, review of the jail inmate agreement. And that would be Pete and Chief Dowdy. Where did Chief go? He left. Okay.
Here he comes.
All right, Chief, you're up.
Okay. We've discussed this again in our budget review. We are obviously without many options. I think looking at the start, what we recommended, what the discussions have been with the sheriff, there have been some give and take with chief and one of the officers there. So now it's down. This agreement ends June 30th. And I would recommend that we accept this agreement for $48.48 for prisoners.
Okay.
And move forward with that. So.
How much of an increase is that?
About 8.3%.
Okay. Do we have to get an explanation of why 8%?
Yes, sir. That's how much their expenses went up.
Any other questions?
I do have a question. Rob, have you read that OCGA statute that they mentioned in under the cost per day, that number one, it says OCGA 15-21-90?
I have not.
15-21-90. It's I got it pulled up here. It's the Georgia Payment and Disposition of Fines and Forfeitures, Jail Construction and Staffing. It's also known as the Jail Construction and Staffing Act. My question is this, and this is semantics, I guess, but it really is not. In their agreement, it says that the money is deposited into the county general fund. This law states that it will go into a special account. Hold on, let me find it again. It says, such sums paid over to the governing authority shall be deposited by the governing authority into a special account to be known as the county jail fund. I mean, and then that's 15-21-94, and then 95 talks about the actual things that it's supposed to go to pay for, like staffing and construction of the jail, if there's any debt left on it. Well, I guess is what I'm asking is dumping it into the county general fund versus putting it into the special account, does it leave us any window for for discussion? I mean, because they're using it for whatever they want. They don't necessarily.
Okay, well, first of all, you're talking about two different things.
Yeah.
You have a fee that's mandated by law, then you have the per diem, which is negotiated. They're two different things.
Okay, so now what?
That's two different issues. State law requires us to pay a certain percentage. And so far this year, we've paid them about $67,000 on that under Title 15. But then you have the per diem, which is completely different. And that's the negotiations we have, and it's the fee they charge us to house our inmates.
So what's the other first thing you said we're paying them? First?
Just the add-on fee.
When you pay a fine, you know, in court, then, you know, there's all these assessed add-ons to that fine, and one of them is this jail construction fee that is assessed on that fine. So that's separate from us having to pay to house our prisoners.
Well, that's what that sentence says. It says this per diem is in addition to cost.
There's actually 10 different things that comes out of those fines, 10 different funds we have to pay by state law.
So I guess what I'm asking is, so we pay money through our county, on our county taxes for, I thought, the jail, then we had the 10%. Now I can understand the 10%.
Okay. Their answer to that is, it's up to us to add that to the fine, so the person who is paying the fine is actually paying that, not the city.
Are we doing that?
That's right. I mean, basically.
Are we doing that?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Okay. All right,
so
any other questions?
I want to clarify, since I was quoted as saying that the increase was outrageous several weeks ago, which I did say outrageous, but at that point we thought it was 16%. So I'll withdraw my outrageous comment to the 8.3.
To what?
Which, I didn't come up with a different word than outrageous, but,
okay.
But 8.3, and they didn't do one last year, so not as outrageous.
It's a little more understandable.
It's not as outrageous as I thought it was. Okay. Was good.
Okay. Any other comments, questions on this contract? All right. Do you want to go ahead and address the school resource officers?
We can.
I was trying to find me a one.
There's two items we want to talk about. The first is with the current SROs. There's currently five SROs in place. We did have a talk last year about the budget. We did present to them that we wanted to see if the Board of Ed would pick up a little more of the costs, and that was verbally agreed upon. So the chief has been working with folks at the Board of Ed here recently. They're still hashing out some of the details on this year's contract, and I explained to Patrick today that we needed it for mid-month, and what I'm being told is the additional funds, if you remember, we put almost $80,000 of additional money towards that SRO in the general fund budget, so I made that vividly clear that that has to be in there. So I'm assuming that by our mid-month meeting, that'll be before you with the monies in addition to what the school pays now for the SRO. So we still feel good, and Chief will be talking as as this week goes on about the contract itself. So everything is good on that front.
So where does that bring us with what's our cost, including health insurance, including pension? I mean, cost for cost. So how much is school board paying, and how much are we paying for the current bunch with the 80,000? What is it? Where does it bring with that 80,000? What's that differential now?
The total cost of the SROs for this year would have been $265,000. That includes their current salary, FICA taxes, life insurance, workers' comp, health. The only thing it did not include was retirement. Retirement is a, I don't want to say a fickle number, but it's so arbitrary, there's no formula to figure out what that number is. We don't include that. So if you do the math, the officers spend about 69% of their time in the school. They spend 31% of their time working for us. But the way the contract is written is they get paid for the days that children are required to be at school. So they reimburse us, they have been reimbursing us 50% of that money for those 10 months. Now what we've asked them to do from here forward is reimburse us 100% of that money for those, that 69%.
They're talking about six more SROs, is that correct?
We ain't got to that yet. You're not told, but yeah, that's a different, that's coming from a different discussion. I want to get these current ones that we were doing. So does the 80,000 bring us to 100% of the 69% of the time that they're there?
69%.
Well, they're at the school 69% right. of the time. So the school should be responsible for 69% of the cost.
That's right. So the additional $80,000, that would bring us whole.
100% of the cost.
Yes.
That's going to bring us very, very close. You got to realize the personnel in the school is going to change this year. So one guy that's making $45,000 will be replaced with somebody making $35,000. So his benefit package will be different. So there's always a little variable there, but it's going to bring us very, very close. It's a lot closer than $90,000 we're off now.
I'm going to ask a question you probably don't know the answer to. Some of the schools that are located in the county, like J.T. Reddick, Omega, some of these other schools, is the county, are they asking the county to staff SRO?
I know that the county does the same thing we do. The officers that are on duty go by every day and check on the schools. But as far as having somebody in school full time, mm-hmm. I do not believe they do.
I got you.
Patrick was looking to us
to. So the 80 is there. We're not at 100%, but you think it's close.
It may be sufficient when we change the personnel. It may be a little more than what we need.
Except for the pension. And pension. Wayne, what's the pension on those people? $12,000 total?
$12,353. But if you take Jody Abad out of that equation, all of a sudden that goes to probably $500. A new person, we don't put anything in their pension fund for the first year. So if we put a new person in there, there is no retirement expense.
Well, I appreciate that. But and I wouldn't charge them anything for that. But I charge them $12,000 for the rest of them.
Well, but it sounds like we've got to operate in ranges. I don't think it's ever going to be an exact.
This was last year. Now this is not this coming year. This was what we paid last year.
I appreciate that, and I don't disagree with you on ranges, but the range can't be zero.
Right. We made it really clear that this year that money we have it in the general fund budget, so we have to have that if that's the expectation.
If we get close to that, even without the pension, next year definitely got to have the pension. I mean, it's only fair to the taxpayers and the city of Tesla.
I think that they would eat that $12,000 every day of the week to know that their child is safe at school.
I agree with that, but the county people aren't paying anything. And the point is, the city of Tifton taxpayers are supporting it, one year and the other. So I'm all for safety too. That's not the issue. So.
All right. So any other comments?
Yeah, we're good on that. Now, that's the current contract and the number of officers. We will have that determined by the next meeting.
Okay.
In the packet, the Board of Ed also said that they did put $260,000 of additional funding in the budget for us to requested, if we can, to look at six additional SROs. So once we have the contract for this coming year, we're going to talk about exactly what they have in mind, how much money they do exactly have, and then what the possibilities of us bringing new SROs on in this particular time.
Which I think is where you were going. Do you have a question?
Oh, I love that idea.
That'll cost us 74.
So they're saying total would be $520,000 that they're going to spend towards SROs, is that correct?
Yes.
You're saying 260, we're going to fund 260 for the six that we already got, but we'd like six more, so 12 total.
We were going to ask them for an additional, for total next year, about 195,000 plus. They said they budgeted 260, so that's what your number would have been.
195.
Getting back to the point that was raised earlier, some of these schools are in the county rather than the city, so shouldn't the county sheriff's office handle those?
We don't do the ones in the county.
They're not in the county?
We don't go to Reddick or Omega.
Those are the only two.
Okay. Any other questions on the school resource officers?
Well, the new ones, the six new ones, tell me again, some numbers were thrown out there as to the six, is it still the 69% of the time is going to be there. And that's 100, you're talking about 164,000 without insurance and retirement.
Yes, sir. I just wanted to make sure that the council understood that when they offered $260,000, that it was not a zero cost to us. That, you know, I'm sure they're only going to pay for the 10 months that they're in school, the 69-70%. And I didn't want the council to blindly say this is a great idea without understanding it's going to cost us at a minimum of $75,000. Because when we start adding the health insurance retirement to it, it's going to be more than that.
Because we have to cover their employment the
and
rest
that,
of the year.
That was just to give you a minimal expense of what it would be.
They're going to pay 260 for those six.
No, sir. They budgeted that much. They don't
all
pay that much. No, sir. An additional $260,000.
Yeah. On top.
Okay. Well, just tell me what the 164 becomes when you add insurance, and we'll forego pension. So for this year. But we need to collect. We don't need to back up.
Well, that's just it.
On the old ones.
I can't tell you that until I tell you who those six are, because we might be paying zero for health insurance, we might be paying $8,000, we might be paying $24,000, and I don't know who that person is yet.
All right. And that's where the range comes in. But my point is, we've gotten to the 100% or near about on the current ones, and for years we didn't. If we're going to start some new ones, start them out at that 100%. We can't go back to this subsidizing the school board, and that's what we're doing.
Again, adding six SROs just like that is a tall order anyway. So I think this contract this year will define costs, expenses, and then we can build our model for what they exactly want. And I think they need to tell us, do we want to realistically try to put three in, or do you want to realistically put two additional one, or do you want to try to go for all six? So we need to know that. So we
and that's for y'all to work out.
Yeah,
just get 100% of the money.
Got it.
Okay. All right. Any other comments, questions on school resource officers?
Thank you,
Chief. That's good. Thank you. All right. The next item is review of the proposed budget tax digest projections. Pete, you want to go with that?
Yeah. Wayne's going to come up and go through. We do not have many changes. If you have comments or anything that you'd like to look at, we're locked in. There was a page that we did have to adjust because we're working with ESG on the sewer. So I adjusted three columns, but it really had no impact on the budget, so I want to make sure you knew that. I think he has that. So all in all, the document is ready for you. If there's no other questions, then we're good if you are. So going to the digest, and Wayne and I can talk through, but it's just a little premature to talk about the digest when we talk about the rollback rate, talking about our numbers, because it's not exact yet. We don't anticipate that until probably early July, being able to make that. But I can tell you, it's going to be in between two ranges, that the millage stays the same at 9.759. That would give an additional $69,352. This is without changing millage rate. This is a 2.09% increase. That's from where we are right now. That's on one end. On the other end, it's probably going to be a little more conservative, 9.628 for the millage. A That's a .131 decrease to the mill, or $24,000 increase more than what we collected 2017. So it is good. I just can't give you exacts on what your options are at this particular point without the exact numbers. And we should have that in July, where we actually set the millage rate and you make your decisions as you what you see fit to do this. But either way, we do not have to have a public hearing, you know, I don't think you could call it a tax increase because we're starting at that. So you have some flexibility. Once we have the numbers, I'm going to give you those two options again, or where the numbers lie, and you can make your decisions based off of that.
Okay.
As far as the budget, I miss anything? Everything's good. I'd like to I'll maybe email you that page for ESG.
Okay.
Because I did not, I missed a certain line item, so that was my fault. I'll put that back in, but it doesn't change the overall bottom line.
Okay. Any questions, comments on the budget? Okay.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. All right, we've already discussed item number 11 under resolutions. Now we are on item number 12 in our agenda under resolutions. Resolution providing for an alcohol new alcohol license for El Limon located at 501 South Ridge Avenue. Jessica, do you want to bring us that information?
This was brought before council a couple months ago for El Limon. Mr. Limon did not have his parking and building plans approved yet. Mm-hmm. Since that time, he has gotten everything approved by environmental management, and so we're bringing it back for you. Staff is recommending approval of the application.
Okay.
If you said the parking is, he hadn't got the parking squared away yet?
Yes, he has. When we brought it back the first time, it was not, the plans were not reviewed by environmental management, so we held it, but they have been approved now.
And all permitting and everything is in place.
Yes, I believe he has his building permit.
Yes, that's correct.
Pete, what's your view on this?
You know, I've heard about some complaints, the location of having the bar located right here in the middle of the businesses. I've heard from one of the business owners there's been some discussions about that. So, again, from where the bar is located, I have an uneasy feeling because of the complications it could cause. And when you gather like that, additional parking is going to be an issue. So it is going to be a complicated manner. Personally, we've heard some of the complaints, but again, we want to promote new businesses. So this is a very unique one, I think, solely because of the location of where it is, what's around it, and what obviously we are going to endure if you're talking about after midnight activities. Business owners getting mad because they're on their parking, or things, other things happen. So I don't want to, discourage that, but this is a really tough situation because of exactly where it's located.
Do we need to do any more review or discussion, or is there anything else we can do to address that? And we've all, I think, most of us have gotten a phone call with concerns, and how do you balance, like you said, the ability to open a business with the concerns of the neighboring property owners? And
can Rob say, because there's some business right around, and is there any responsibility for the owner of the bar to what happens when these people leave and they go next door and mess something up?
Well, I've had conversations myself with some of the adjoining business owners, and quite frankly, it's properly zoned for a bar. I think that there are concerns about what may happen, and I agree with Pete. I don't know of any basis upon which to deny an alcohol license if they are meeting all the zoning requirements and all other requirements. But I do recognize the fact that we need to address the concerns of the businesses by making sure that we keep a close eye on making sure that that business, that bar is being properly conducted, and it has not created any type of a nuisance or other violation of the ordinances. And, you know, we've dealt with those issues before. We can deal with those issues if they happen. But I think that, at least at this point in time, it's a little speculative about what may happen. But I think that we certainly should take close consideration of making sure that if there's already problems, that council is ready to address those issues.
What's the law around the responsibility of serving, not necessarily number of drinks, but serving people until they become just totally intoxicated?
That's illegal. You cannot, you know, a bartender cannot serve somebody who is noticeably intoxicated, is my understanding. I think that's the law. So, again, it's just something that, you know, if a business owner who has a bar complies with the law and complies with our ordinances, then the business owners, you know, should not have an issue. They'll have an issue if they don't. And I think if those issues arise, then we need to address it.
So theoretically, somebody could be clearly intoxicated and leave there and go next door and break a window out, and police come, and he's clearly intoxicated. They can go back to the business owner and say, you know, you've clearly served alcohol to somebody, you know, and you shouldn't. I mean, theoretically.
Theoretically, and of course, the issue that we run into is actually from an evidentiary standpoint, how you prove that.
Yeah.
But a lot of times, you know, they break a window, and before we can get an officer over there, they've hightailed it out of
right.
there. So it's a problem, and it's a difficult problem to address. But I think we just, you know, hopefully Buddy and his group can do the best they can to kind of keep an eye on it, and let's see what happens.
Yeah, if the business meets all the requirements, I don't see how we can deny it. But as you say, we need to keep an eye on it, because it could cause problems, or it may not cause problems. We don't know.
That's right.
It's all speculative.
We don't want to borrow trouble.
Any other questions? Pete, can you get with Johnny on his concerns and
certainly
let him address that?
And we could have those listings when it comes to you mid-month, if there's anything that we could do that we want to address and make sure we read into the minutes that we'll be looking for, then we certainly can.
Okay, thank you. Okay. All right, thank you. Jessica, you want to go to the next one for Joe Petra, doing business as Jay's Food Mart?
Jay's Food Mart is a current location at 10 Sandra Drive, and this is just an ownership change. And staff has reviewed the application and is recommending approval of it also.
Okay, any questions on that one? All right.
It's a manager change?
Ownership. They have an owner and a manager, though.
Jay's Food Mart, Central Drive. Where's that?
That's off Berry Lake Road. All right. Any other questions on that? All right. Jeff West, declaring surplus property.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. This is a request to declare the mobile home at 2075 Windmill Road as surplus for demolition. This is out there at our guest apartment. It's a single white trailer there that's been there for years that used to be rented out from the city, but I went in the other day and we've looked at it. The floors are rotten. It is beyond repair. And we just think we should go ahead and demolish it and sell the scrap and get rid of it.
Okay. Any comments, questions on that? Lovely property. All right. Thank you, Jeff. All right, Jessica, Enterprise Zone application for Larry Mims for the property located at 223 East 2nd Street.
I'm going to let Mr. Pete finish the
discussion. Okay.
I'll be back up if he needs
me. Okay, no problem.
We'll do this together. I want to begin by saying in our meeting this morning, Enterprise Zone applications, we need to address this, and I need to take care of a couple items that we need to address properly in this application. So that is
okay. That's
after this event.
Okay.
We did receive an application from Mr. Mims about a building downtown, and it's rehabbing, pressure washing, priming it, and painting it. looks as though a total of $8,838 of improvements. And obviously, Mr. Mims does, he will do a great job with that, and we like to encourage, you know, the older buildings to be rehabbed. Now, where it comes into a little difficult area, and the provisions that we use with regards to Title 36, which is enterprise zones, it says that that if the project consists of a new residential construction, residential rehab, or other rehab of an existing structure, and the value of the improvement exceeds the value of the land by a ratio to 5-1, then the exemption schedule in subsection A shall also apply, whether or not the project is carried out. So, I say that the 5-1 ratio on the land, we are right at the threshold, and we have to address enterprise zones as real incentives. And if they don't meet the threshold, this is not a facade type grant, or it's not monies that we are prepared to give away. And I'll give you, for instance, like landfill, and we've addressed it before. Ricky has his hands tied because he has no earthly idea how much they're going to dispose of. And our application says we're gonna do 100% of it. We're gonna abate every one of it. So if he takes, you know, $13,000 worth of junk out there, we're gonna pay for it. So it has gotten us in a budgetary crunch in the past. We have to fix and update the application itself. But with regards to Mr. Mims, it'll be your decision. This the 5-1 ratio is really, really
important. You know, we have discussed that there could potentially be areas of the community that these incentives are currently in place for, that they've reached their threshold. They've done their job with regard to spurring development and proper development. So maybe we should pull those areas out and then reapply enterprise and opportunity zones to other areas that need that jump start for development. So it probably would be best if you could look at everything that you've just talked about as far as, you know, where we are with this, the amount of money that we've allocated for these zones, which are good things for development, and where would they best be used? Where could we maybe close off the enterprise and opportunity zone opportunities and focus them on other areas that maybe need them now?
Okay, we can do that. Jessica and I talked about that today, and I think a threshold is good. We can't approach it haphazardly.
No.
But when you're talking about, you know, $2 million or $1.5 million bucks for, it's a little different. So
right.
We have to determine that, and I think we have to put that in some schedule. I think in the end, what we have to do is probably spread this out a little bit or move it out of the downtown a little more, because
so.
We need to really start getting some of the buildings back on the tax.
Well, some of these are these incentives were put in place to eliminate blight and that kind of thing, and high crime areas and all. So they've served their purpose in our downtown area. I think they've done lots of, thankfully, what they were supposed to do. So
it's really hard, and we abate taxes for 10 years. It's really
yeah.
a stretch.
Okay. Well, let's reevaluate that as we're going into the new budget year, and let you come back to us maybe with a proposal on what would be the best practice to
Thank you.
Carry those forward and where. That sound fair to everybody? Are you good with that? Okay. All right. Thank you. All right. We are now under the ordinances section of our agenda, and we just had all of the public hearings and all of those ordinances relating to that rezoning. Would be what we'd be discussing. Does anyone have any other questions or comments regarding those rezoning applications? I think we've talked about everything we need to. All right, do we need to, let's drop down to, I guess we need to drop down to number 20, Rob, with the ordinance amending the Land Development Code regarding parking standards and design.
Yes, Mayor and Council, I'll take this one. I think I'll let Danny handle the other two.
Okay.
But this has been kind of something we wanted to fix for a long time. The way that the code currently reads is that, talking about parking lots, it says all multifamily, commercial, industrial uses shall provide a paved, dust-free surface. And what we want to do is put in or. So it would read, shall provide a paved or dust-free surface. I think, you know, the way it is now, you can interpret it, meaning you have to have a paved surface.
Right.
In lieu of a paved or dust-free.
Okay.
So all we're doing is adding the word or, so that it can be paved or dust-free, such as crush and run, something like that.
Is that good? Everybody clear on that? Okay, all right. All right, you wanna go on to the streets section?
Danny? Let's come up and explain what you wanna do here.
You had the ordinance, remember you, this has your name by it, not mine. Council, mayor, the definitions in our current land development code says that street houses and developments are supposed to be on streets. If you look at the definition of streets, it says avenues, streets, and it also calls out alleys. If you look at the definition of an alley, it says that it is meant as a service entrance, not as the primary entrance to the property. So it's ambiguous, and we would just like to clear up the code. So we would like to add a line in the definition of street that says alleys or those streets deemed similar shall not serve as the primary entrance to a property for design standards for lots in 4.01.01.
Okay.
Right. And that'll make it clear to developers.
That's fine. All right, any questions on that? I think we all understand that and the reason for that, so. Okay, excellent. What he said. Right.
Yeah,
and that's primary entrance.
We just got into that with this gentleman.
Oh, yes. That's true.
Yeah.
All right, Rob, you wanna go over the establishing, I can't even say that word, whatever that word is.
I can't either, Mayor, so that's one of the game. But bottom line, we don't have a classification for these type of facilities. And so, but this is just basically adding in our table of uses these type of
photovoltaic systems.
Right, and wind.
Solar array.
Solar farms, wind farms.
So this is doing nothing more than just adding a category to our land uses,
okay,
which we don't currently have.
Okay, any concern, questions on that?
The reason why we're doing this actually is we were questioned out of Atlanta saying that it's not in your zoning, so therefore we assume we could put it anywhere.
Okay.
We do have it now, don't we?
That's correct.
Somewhere.
And the
how
president was SA, suburban agriculture, which is what was saying that with this table of uses, it'll be allowed to be done.
Solar farm.
Solar farm.
Okay. The other thing though, just go ahead.
Okay.
Go ahead.
All right. All right, thank you, Danny. I think we're good. All right, we are now under the other business section of our agenda, and item number 23 is review of the letter from Golden Environmental. Pete, you want to go over that?
Yes, ma'am. I did receive on June 1st a letter from Richard Golden, obviously he's been serving us for 3.5 years. In the contract, it states that after this time frame, he is allowed to submit an increase based off of his costs. He has done that. This letter actually is a formal request of increasing prices to $16 a house, which is $15.13, I believe, the current cost is. So almost a dollar increase for Golden Environmental for garbage recycle and yard trash. That's all into one. So I told Richard, he's back here, okay. We talked about this. It's time, if you so choose to do it, obviously this would be passed on to our customers for the increase. We have not addressed the landfill. I have not taken that up with the county manager yet. So this is just for collection activity purposes. So again, if you're ready to make this decision or if you're ready to push it back to the committee, we could certainly do that, but we have to, obviously Richard knows it too, we have to address the junk and bulk waste within the city. So we this dollar, I don't know if it would do that, if it would make any difference, or would Richard would, you know, increase the service. He and I have not talked about that yet, but we have discussed that that's one of the issues that we need to finalize. So again, as we talked about in the budget, if we want to do bulk ourselves, we can. I can talk to Richard about removing that from his contract, or we go to Richard and say we're increasing prices, and he's, you know, obviously able to pick up bulk maybe every week. And I, again, I don't have those details for you tonight, but it is something that we need to talk about. So we,
I would suggest that the Public Ways Committee take a look at this.
Okay.
And come back to council.
Okay.
So, what committee?
Our Public Ways Committee, which is Frank and Johnny. Richard's here tonight. I don't know if y'all have any specific questions. I know he'd be happy to answer those. Richard, I'm putting you on the spot a little
Absolutely.
Bit.
Absolutely.
But I would like for y'all, Pete and Richard and Johnny and Frank to get together to kind of go through these. I know you had some specific questions of the kind of what level of service do we want as the council want to provide to the customers. That's in your letter. So I didn't know if you wanted to just give us, you know, sort of some, a general comment or whatever while the committee works together through everything. So.
Okay. Well, thank you. Thank you for the time, Mayor and Council. I did address that to Pete at the end of last week. I think there's just a air of frustration on my part and the city and also the customer on the bulky items and the waste that's in no man's land.
Right.
And who to address it, okay? It's not addressed in the contract. So we need to either broaden the contract and get some clarity there so that it's not just, you know, no man's land. Specifically, houses that are for sale, for clothes, for rent, nobody's there, no service. Trash is out there, yard waste is out there, bulky items are out there, and then also items that are not in the can, I'd say like clothes, old books, knickknacks. So that's really has to be in the can. So there's really needs to be a little thought, and maybe get together and kind of figure that out. I'm game for anything.
Okay. And what we're seeing too is that someone will go and dump materials on property that's not theirs.
Oh, absolutely.
As you know, and then all of a sudden it starts piling up, and that becomes the site. And we've got a street in town behind the Dairy Queen, Potts Road, is just lined with somebody's garbage. I don't know whose it is, but somebody's. Yeah, South Park. So,
how do we educate the public? I ride by and I look, and there's a pile of limbs. I'm thinking, well, I wonder why they didn't pick that up. And I look closer, and there's a couch in the middle of it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so, and then a neighbor, a constituent called, I got it picked up. She says, well, they wouldn't do this. I said, we can't be combined. I didn't know that. She said, so now I'll put it separate. How do we better educate the public?
Well, I think that's rampant. Okay. I'd say 50% of all the yard trash piles are contaminated with some bottles or newspapers or something that we actually pick it out, because we can't deliver that to the inert landfill.
Right.
So actually, our guys pick that out, cleaning that up, which we don't mind that. We know there's some portion there. To educate, yes, we could probably try to do something through mail out. Maybe Pete, I don't know.
Or could you even, like the house that has the trash with the couch in it, even a door hanger or something that says you can't have this mixed. I mean, some people just don't know.
Right.
They should know, but they don't know.
But now that, and go back to the contract, that, you know, that's not in my contract to police that or.
And I realize why you don't pick it up, but you see it.
I see it.
You see it.
That's
you're
right.
You're the one that can help us to tell, you know, because we don't necessarily see it.
Right.
That's why I ask you, how can you, what can you help us do so that
I'd be glad to, if that's the direction.
Well,
that
and what I think we ought to do is, I know that the committee, that, you know, we all talk and we hear, but if we could, just like we had asked everyone to address their concerns for the RFP for the banking to Pete, if we could get our list of concerns, share that with the committee,
yeah,
And then y'all sit down and kind of dissect and go through all that, and then we'll see, you know, see how things shake out, I think. And then bring something back to the council saying, this
and
is...
And the committee did a great job.
Yeah.
And we sent Richard a letter, and we talked about educational materials
right.
and door hangers and stickers for the cans. And so we've been through all this, and I think what we're now, final decision, and I think this rests on you, how do you want to handle junk pickup, because I think that's the bullseye for us.
That's the main,
an issue of longstanding.
Yeah, Richard, he does a good job with, you know, picking up the garbage and yard trash. I mean, it's heavy, but we've got to get better with that. Recycle, we don't have any issues. Our product is pretty clean.
Mm-hmm.
So I think this is, it becomes down to a service for you and for the residents and how you want to address it.
Yes, sir, Mr. Correll.
Richard, like the junk pile, like a couch or a television.
Yes.
Like, okay, people that rental property, well, they have rental property. The service is not there. Once the renter moved out, then the service is not there. But now, could we or could you address the property owner about piling all this stuff out there? Could you let them know that this is not in your, maybe I'm going too far here, but could you, let's just say the property owner on South Park, they got four apartments full of furniture there. Now, the service is not there. So that's junk. Now, and I don't see you picking it up because there's no service. But now, is there a way, since you don't pick it up, is there a way that you could notify the property owner and tell them that you're not going to pick it up, and that's that is their responsibility to get it moved?
Well, I've done that.
Okay.
Yeah, that's really out of the code enforcement area, so we... And
okay. I know it's comfortable, but I want it
puts me in a very awkward position.
Right.
Well, you have no authority.
Right. I don't have the authority, and it makes it look like I'm going to say, okay, landlord, I'm the money grubbing trash man, but you're going to pay more.
Okay.
Do you see what I'm saying?
Okay. Okay.
Because it's out of my thing. You know, I can't, it's just not in me to go tell them that they need to pay more.
But I believe your contract states that you should work with the city so that we know that's sitting there so we can do something with it.
So that had to be done by.
Yeah, I think those are the things that y'all can sit down in the meeting and fine tune and bring something back. So let's do that.
Yeah.
And what we'll do is we'll email you all any specific concerns that we have, so that y'all, before y'all,
and I think we're at a point now where we got to, you know, say, here we are. Is this a level of service you want to be at? And Golden takes the responsibility to clean up 90% of all the situations out there. Yes, we could do that.
Okay.
And but that comes with
a cost.
Or the city of Tifton says, we're going to take care of all that outside of your scope.
Okay.
So if we could come together there.
Yeah, that's the number one thing.
Meet in the middle, I think we're going to be the best for all of us.
There we go.
Okay. We'll be in good hands.
Good outline
right
there. Okay. And I'm you know, flexible with time. If Pete can give me, you know, a day or two, I'm good. All right.
Okay. So
thank you.
Good hands. So just email concerns to these two gentlemen, and then they will take it from there. All right, we are approaching the end of our agenda. City manager report. I would like for you to update everyone on the service delivery information, if you don't mind, and I'd like to share the latest meetings that we've had, or if you would like to, one of us, I think, needs
sure.
to bring everyone up to speed on this.
So do we need to add this as an item, or we just talk about it? Is that okay?
I think that'd be all right.
Okay. All right, so everyone knows where we are with regards to what we did, the Form 2 for the Patty Cake House. We have suggested specifics to Tiff County. Their meeting obviously didn't produce anything except what they gave us initially. So as of as of this weekend and as of today, Rob and I are prepared to share two things with you. Number one, a letter to the Department of Community Affairs, and then two, sample forms that are actually filled out correctly. And what I mean by correctly, the 9 or the 8 services that we were pending, the details of them, expiration dates on the others, very, very specific information on the exact forms. So that's what we're prepared to do. I will tell you before I hand this out, I did call Jim this morning and said I wanted to know if you were going to send me anything from the meeting. And he said, yes, I'll do a summary and send you the updated forms. So I want to hand this out to you. And he said, if that's the case, please send the signed form so at least we understand what's going on, what was signed, what wasn't, if there is any changes. So what he sent us is the same forms. He did a revision of Form 2 and noted under E that Tift County Board of Commissioners is the organization that will provide the service. I don't understand. That's on Form 2.
And that's for the
Patty Cake House.
Okay.
There's no changes on Form 3 and Form 4. He gave me, and then at the last is the letter to Rusty Haygood, where Jim updated. It says, in particular, the interlocal agreement regulating the delivery of water and wastewater service, as identified on SDS Form 4, Number 3, will require additional modifications, which we already knew that. I asked for the signed copies. I did not get it. So I don't know if they signed the copies. I don't know what they did, but Jim did not.
Well, he also noticed here in his cover letter, says, furthermore, you inquired if the county had made any determination concerning a joint council commission meeting on June the 15th. That's not what we asked for. We said by June the 15th.
That's right.
So he's misunderstood that.
Well, it's very clear, but again, I asked for the signed documents. If
right.
That was the action of the commission, I do not know, so I can't tell you any different than we knew last week. But we're prepared. Where's the letter?
Well, tell me when you're ready for me to jump in.
I'm ready. That's okay. As of today, because
I've been
talking to
Jim
personally.
Well, and I want to bring everyone up to date. After we had our meeting on Thursday afternoon, I felt it was very important that Pete and I go meet with as many members as possible of the board of Ruth's Cottage and Patty Cake House to explain basically what happened in our meeting Thursday. And so they were able to call together basically the executive board. So there were, I think, 4 or 5 people that were in attendance that day at the meeting. One that was on a conference call, she was out of town but didn't want to participate. And then Lynn Lovett, who was not on the executive board but certainly is part of the capital campaigns committee that's working so diligently on this new facility. So we went and met with them, said we want to be very transparent and basically give you the opportunity to hear from us our concerns and to ask us any questions, because so often it's easy to assume something or formulate information or details when you don't have all of the facts. So I felt like we'd had a very positive, very good meeting with them that afternoon. I did find out that after we left there was some ongoing discussion, several concerns. The article then came out in the Tifton Gazette on Sunday, which I think the headlines were sensationalistic, in my opinion, if that's a word, to say that this grant is in jeopardy because of these actions, I think is irresponsible reporting. I don't make the headlines, that's just a Julie Smith comment. We did not have a chance to address any of the statements that the commission made, which I think were short-sighted, but I don't we have nothing to do with the rules of reporting and how that's presented to the public. We did meet again this afternoon. Pete and I met with Lynn Lovett and Jim Laycock. Lynn being the, again, the capital campaigns person, Jim being the chairman of the either board or executive board, but certainly an executive board member. They have basically asked us, implored and begged, I mean, Lynn's exact words, we're here sort of begging, for you to go ahead and sign these documents so that our project is not in jeopardy. And I want to reiterate, the Department of Community Affairs has given us several options, and the option that keeps getting presented back to us that's again, one more time in this email, although you asked for something else, this is what we keep getting, is only one option that's open to this council. And I reiterated to Ms. Lovett and to Mr. Laycock, there are circumstances by which if the appropriate changes were made to these documents, I would be willing to sign this evening. This is another reason that I think that we need a joint meeting. Vice Mayor Ehlers went to the commission meeting that was held Friday morning requesting that. We requested that in our letter. I find that it was interesting that letter was not shared with the commission and Mr. Carter's normal mode of communication with his commission. I guess that's up to him to determine how he wants to discuss things, but I can tell you if 99.9% of the time Pete emails us with information we need, that's time is of the essence and it's pertinent information that's extremely important, and then find out that, well, he just made a copy and put it in our box, which we're not always in City Hall, I'd be very frustrated and would certainly be having a phone call, a private conversation with you. So we, again, are up at this impasse. I cannot sign documents that are incorrect and will not sign documents that are incorrect. And I really have an issue with the Department of Community Affairs continuing to say, this is your only option, when in fact I've had a personal phone call with Mr. Haywood who said there's actually several options that you have. This option fits what they want to do. We have other options that are open to us. I know Rob has worked with Wes and with Jack over the weekend to put together the proper forms, and yet here we are again, wasting time, in my opinion. Today is June the 4th, so.
Okay, so that's a good summary. This is where we are today, and again, the only thing I think everyone wants is to say, DCA, listen to us.
Yes.
Specifically, and please help us break down this initial barrier that has been set. So I'm going to let Rob take it from here. He has done a great job with this.
While you're passing that, let me ask, I was reading this letter
from Grady
from Grady to Rusty Haygood. What? I guess what I understand, there's multiple dates that DCA says you can extend and ask for an extension. Now, the county has chosen to ask for it to be extended to June 30th, 2019. Were we asked? Is that what we wanted? If we were going to extend it, we'd extend it to June 30th, 2019?
No.
Or did they just take it upon themselves, being the county, and I'm sorry, and just say, well, that's the date, DCA, we want to extend it to that?
That is a clear assumption, and I think I asked Jim why he did this, but he sent my letter and called DCA again Friday, I assume, to say, here's what the city's presenting, can you send, you know, is there anything that we need to talk about, and reiterated the fact that we want to extend, we being the county, wanted to extend to June 30th, 2019, so
there's no consideration.
So no consideration, once again, I mean, enough is enough.
Well,
we are the city, and the county's not going to tell us what to do.
Well, I think extending is what we need. We need to have these termination dates on these services. If we could go in and go back to these documents and insert the termination dates that we feel...
And we can communicate with the county,
right.
What dates do you think? We wouldn't arbitrarily say,
no,
we're going to extend to X.
A negotiated...
A year, 12 months, I mean... It's going to take that long, I think, to get to the bottom of some of those
Whether it will or won't.
But not everyone.
October, February, whatever. We could do 2 years.
So what would you want to do? You get it every 4 months.
If you get it done, you could actually get it done in October. If you truly wanted to get it done, we could talk for the next 12 months. And if you're not willing, yeah.
It's just this, it's this.
You don't have a year to do it, but at least be asked.
It's just very frustrating, and I'm sure it's frustrating for the community to have to try to understand it. It's very convoluted and confusing. I know it's easy to say, just sign the thing and go on and let's get the grant. And I wish that I could do that, but I cannot.
Okay, so here's where we are. We, on Thursday, you chose to do a resolution.
We did.
And a correct Form 2 to get the Patty Cake House out of the way.
Exactly.
Send it up to DCA. That was our request. The county has not acted on that. So what is presented, and Rob's gonna tell you, there's two things that we are now prepared to do, if it's your desire. So Rob, talk about the letter.
Mayor, basically, and y'all have a draft of a letter to DCA, and basically what we would like DCA to do is to inform both the city and the county what needs to be done. As we have said all along, is that according to the initial DCA correspondence, they want us to submit a form, Form 1, that basically says that all of our services as they existed back in 2008 and the manner in which those services are being funded is still the case. Well, we have outlined about 9 things that we all know is different from 2008, which is basically prevents us from certifying that the, as things are today, are the same as they were in 2008. I have prepared these Form 2s, and I believe they're close to being final, and what I was hoping to do is to present these Form 2s to the county for discussion. So we can, you know, if we have some differences, we can address those. But basically, I think there are some major services that need to be corrected because they have been changed since 2011. Particularly animal control, developmental support services, E911, EMA, fire, mosquito control.
Exactly.
And of course we have issues with water. So back in 2011, you know, as the council is aware, is that the city decided that it was no longer going to pay the county from their general fund for animal control, E911, EMA, and mosquito control. At that point in time, the city quit paying from their general fund to the county for those services. The county then made those services countywide and then adjusted the millage rate on the city residents to pay for those. So obviously that is a significant change in the service providing as well as the funding. So that needs to be corrected. The other issue that was probably the most glaring is the developmental support services. This is where a real problem exists. Back in 2011 is when the city took over their own code, which is inspections and building permits, zoning, and the county was to provide their own. And I believe they provide that for the city of Tai Tai and Omega. The problem is that that is still being paid out of the county's general fund.
Since 2011?
Yes. So basically what that means is that the city residents since 2011 have been paying for the county's code. So that needs to be changed. Obviously, when you have that type of situation, it needs to be placed in a special tax district. That way, according to the service delivery statute, you can ensure that services that are providing only to the unincorporated residents are being paid only by the unincorporated residents. And as it exists now, we are paying for the county code. That has to change. We cannot continue to pay for their code. Naturally, the fire has changed. We have two separate departments. Now they're being funded through the general funds of the county and the city. You could go through each one of these services. The ones that I have proposed changes to, and I think the county agrees that developmental support services needs to change, animal control needs to change, E-911 needs to change. EMA needs to change. Fire needs to change. Mosquito control needs to change. And those are the major.
And that's, and so that means we're more than, I mean, that's the bulk.
That is the bulk of it. And then when you, so really what we're talking about and presenting to the county are making a service delivery strategy consistent with what we're doing now. What I would suggest to council is, you know, we have some of these major services that I think the county would agree needs to be changed.
Absolutely.
If we come to a point where there might be, I'm going to call a lower tiered service for lack of a better word, such as the library. Mm-hmm. Well, maybe we may not be able to come to a complete agreement on the library. We'll keep that as it is.
Sure.
For another year, and then we can deal with it. But the bottom line is what we have been suggesting to the county is that let's get these forms correct. Let's submit a service delivery strategy that is correct and accurate. And then there will be no problem with Roos Cottage in getting that grant through.
Well, I made the comment to Ms. Lovett this afternoon. If this is the council's desire to do this, and I hope that it is, because hopefully this is one more effort to try to fix this problem, if we have to get in the car and Brady Thompson and I, as the chairman, drive this up to DCA tomorrow, that's what we'll do, because it's that important that we try to fix this and try to stay in compliance. But I'd like to sit down at some point in time and have a discussion with the commissioner of DCA to say, Mr. Commissioner, you really put local governments, or your planners put local governments in a very compromised position when you indicate that the best course of action is just sign the stuff like it is, even though you know it's not accurate, so that we can preserve this grant application and fund this grant.
And the problem, and that's that therein lies the problem.
Yes.
Is that because what I believe the DCA is suggesting is to submit these forms as though we have a current 2008 strategy.
Right.
The county is taking that as gospel, and this is the only thing that we can possibly
right.
do. I do not believe that position by DCA is correct.
Right.
I don't know how in the world the city can certify a document to DCA that we know is not accurate.
Well, and you know, I know that this is a very unique situation. I don't think all 159 counties in the state of Georgia are dealing, although they do deal with service delivery at some point in time, I don't think that anyone else has this sort of strange situation where you have service delivery coming due, you have a specific grant application that's very important. You have all these items that are sort of stacking in to create this perfect storm of confusion. So to go to the commissioner and say, Mr. Commissioner, you know, please hand walk this application through because it's so important to Tifton and Tift County. It's just an unusual set of circumstances with the dates and the due dates for everything and the importance of this project. Normally, we would be applying for community development block grants for things that are well within our service delivery strategy. Things like, you know, extending a sewer line or, you know, something, roads or sidewalks or something like that, that is a very defined, specific service of the city or the county. When it was brought in for the Roos Cottage and determined that transitional housing has never been part of our strategy, that began this sort of problematic issue with, you know, changing the current service delivery to include that, which we all agree is the right thing to do, and then trying to get DCA to understand because you've put that extra layer on us, it now created an issue that we need your help with to get all this done properly and accurately and timely.
The solution cannot be to certify, as you said, certify something that is not accurate. And the idea that a government agency like DCA would say that's the recommended solution is ridiculous. And the idea that the county commission would vote unanimously to certify something that is not true.
But they did not have our letter at the time. I know, you're right, I know. But they did not have our letter at the time that they met, which is really disconcerting.
And I appreciate the Roos Cottage people.
Yeah.
but I would move them to their own jobs and whatever. I don't think they'd certify something that was not accurate.
They said that, they agree.
I just don't believe they would.
They said.
But they want us to do it.
Well, it would be my hope that what we have, you know, submitted as Form Two is pretty close to what needs to be submitted. It may need, you know, a few tweaks here and there. But I do believe that the invitation that council is making to the county to meet and get together and discuss these issues, I do believe that it can be accomplished.
I do too.
If we get together, go through the issues, and again, when we start talking about, you know, if we have some issues with some, you know, lower tiered services or, you know, that aren't really too troublesome, you know, we've been limping by with that for 10 years. Maybe we can limp by for another year on some of those to get this job done and then address some of those other issues.
Can I ask a couple of questions about, I mean, a few of these?
Sure.
Engineering. Does the county do any engineering for the city? Then why would theirs come out of general fund? So, I mean, we're just trying to,
I believe,
to get it passed, but I mean, I don't want to put something in here.
I think that
they don't even do some engineering.
Well, it's a service.
It was previously as a service.
Right.
It was previously recognized as a service.
Okay, well, we either need to unrecognize it, or if they decide to start doing it again, they can pay for it out of special tax district.
Well, basically, the way the form is provided is that where the city of Tifton, county, Omega, and Ty-Ty provide their own engineering services, and they are paid for out of those entities' general fund.
That's right, but I don't want Tifton County's to come out of the general fund. But it's okay if the city.
Remember what he said earlier, the second tier services or whatever?
I don't know what kind of say that.
I mean, I understand what you're saying. Engineering would be a primary service, you know.
When is, I'm going to shift gears here, sorry. When is the CDBG funding determined? Did you say it was in August or something?
All applications will start being reviewed August the 3rd.
Okay, well, that's what I want to get to. This headline, Ruth's Cottage funding hindered by service delivery dispute, is wrong.
Let's be clear.
I would like to get a clarification on that, because the Ruth's Cottage board tells me that their understanding from DCA is that this all has to be sent to them by June 30th, or else there's no chance of getting CDBG this year.
That's what they have been told. And that's where, if the chairman and I need to get in the car and drive to Atlanta tomorrow and sit down with the commissioner, I'll make that happen. Because this is an exceptional circumstance. This isn't your normal check the box, fill in the blanks, and send it on, and we rubber stamp it and it goes on. This is mandate. These items are mandated by DCA, but they've tied our hands. They've mandated it in one way, but not given us the resolution or the ability to resolve it in another. So to go to the commissioner, hat in hand, you know, we you know, very respectfully, and say, you know, this, you know, you created these rules for us to live by. And now you've taken away our ability to come to a peaceful resolution, and to add into this mix this project that people are very passionate about. So for the funding for CDBG to not be in effect until August.
Well, yeah, everybody's correct. Let me just go through this one more time, because it's very important. I think we have got to, if we don't have this in the car, you know, hand delivered, signed by next week, I think it's all hands off anyway. So the deadline, this should be heading and packaged up already. So
yeah,
we're a little behind the curve. So
and we're ready to do that. So.
Yes, and that's why we're racing for this deadline. The June 30th deadline, if we don't extend, or we don't do the forms, or we don't acknowledge that by June 30th, then our status becomes no good. If our status becomes no good for the city and for the county, Ruth's Cottage grant falls
without
short.
Question.
And that also affects Ty-Ty and Omega, correct?
Very much. Very
so
much.
All
so,
four of us are affected in this situation.
It is. That's why we're racing for the deadline. I think your logic was right on to get Patty Cake House done, locked in with the form, get it up there, get it gone.
Right. Right.
Go to DCA with that hand, if that's the case, look at the forms, we are close. If we have 8 hours, I guarantee we can knock this out. We all know that water, wastewater's gonna have to be extended.
And those items we can put expiration dates on, which will then trigger reevaluation once they're resolved.
That's right. So the only thing we're asking, and I think Rob needs to go into the DCA letter, is to say, please, we're officially requesting that you take these parameters off that you put in writing on the forefront. We're down the road a little bit. You've got to loosen this up so we have a little more flexibility internally to get these two things done correctly.
Again, because you know what I believe, and I think other legal counsel that we've conferred with agree, that when because DCA has said submit these forms, basically certifying that your current strategy is the same as your 2008 strategy, that we cannot certify that. However, this is the marching orders that they kind of spelled out to Mr. Carter and the county. This is how you do it. However, what I would like to ask DCA is informing them why we cannot do what they have proposed us to do, because
right.
we cannot certify something that is not true.
Right.
And so because the county has been relying on the instructions of DCA, that has totally stopped any conversations or negotiations or concessions of trying to get an accurate strategy accomplished.
In my conversation with Mr. Haygood, that was not the only option. There were other options. And I think in our conversations with our legal counsel, there were other, and that's what we're saying is, county, this is that important that we need to, that would allow us to be in compliance, submit an accurate document that we can sign off on and feel good about, and potentially and hopefully salvage the CDBG grant application for the petty account.
Basically, what I am hopeful in the letter to DCA is that, you know, we get some correction about what is the proper process in order to get this job done. And hopefully that can be some communication, maybe jointly, you know, with the city and the county, so we can break this, you know, roadblock to, you know, having a meeting and making progress towards a
Pete,
negotiated strategy.
Let me ask you a question. This is talking off the cuff here. Would it be possible for you and me to meet with Mr. Carter and Chairman Thompson tomorrow and see if we can't, or do you think that's wise, or do you think this letter needs to go to DCA first? What's the proper sequence of things since we've got no response on a request for a meeting?
My recommendation, the meeting would probably be futile.
Okay.
And I'd give strong consideration to this letter.
Okay.
With a follow-up call to say, do we have to come to Atlanta and get the commissioner on the telephone and say, can you authorize, please, to just loosen up the parameters as we go through this?
Okay.
How much time do we actually have?
So we agree that this is, if we agree that this letter is the right thing, what's the time frame on that? I mean, how does this circulate up through the ranks of DCA to get in the right hands to get that permission?
Well, basically, I think what we'd like to do is probably attach it to an email, fax it, and then
uh-huh.
follow it up with a phone call.
Okay.
I'd like to know all the options DCA has for us here, because there's several options.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to see what all the options they're suggesting. Because
well,
all the fear really is just this one.
That if there's a there's an email, I don't know if we have a copy of it, where they went in and Rob, I don't know if you or Pete may have a copy of that.
I'm looking for it now.
Okay. I don't have it up here.
Yeah, it's not at this particular point. The only really viable option, we took one, but per DCA's guidance is filling out the form twos. Now, we also have to ask DCA, because they said, well, if you give us all these form twos at the same time, we're gonna have to do some work, and that may not look favorably upon the grant. So, which is, anyway.
I know.
Well, let me ask this question.
I've had that permanent look on my face for the last 3 weeks. Really?
Let me ask this question. In the email that Mr. Carter sent to you today, he says he'll ask the commission tomorrow in their meeting if they'll meet with us. on or before the 15th is what we would like, on or before, preferably before, but.
Before, yeah. I think the 15th was our deadline.
Should someone from the city council go to the county meeting? You know, we don't want to step on any toes around here, but would anybody like to go to the city or county meeting to kind of?
You could deliver the forms and asking formally request in their meeting if they would, one, just join in to say, please, DCA, let us loosen the.
I think we ought, I mean, because to me, this letter's got some strong language towards.
Well, the letter's going to DCA, not the county.
I understand that, but you also have to realize that DCA provides a lot of funding for a lot of things. And I don't want to burn any bridges by.
Well, but we can't be held hostage to that.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Now, if the county comes back and says, no, we're not going to meet with you, you know, or whatnot, which I would very seriously doubt, because in the meeting with me, it seemed like that several of the commissioners, and I know four of them off the top of my head, said that they would, that was the right thing to do, that the committees had met, they probably have.
Fulfilled their role.
Yeah, fulfilled their role, and then now a joint meeting is now necessary going forward from these services. But, you know, from everything that I've read, and, you know, Jack and me and Rob, we met for, gosh, we met, what, 4 hours, it felt like. Well, probably was 4 hours on Sunday. And, I mean, we kind of, I felt like we kind of agreed that really the DCA really looks at four things. I mean, they look at, you know, how the service is funded, who's providing the service, is it a tax inequity, and is it a duplication of service? And in John West's email, he says that, you know, we could certainly opt to address modifications to the delivery of other services in this update. And it says, however, the risk of DCA finding items in the documentation would require revision could decrease the likelihood. Well, I mean, most of the changes that we're asking for would be simple changes that I don't feel would be, you know.
That's what we're saying. That's what I'm saying.
The county doesn't want to go along with
it. I think what he was probably saying in this email is saying, if you come in here with a more detailed, bunch of detailed changes, yeah, that's probably going to, you know, decrease the likelihood of us getting this thing done in a timely manner. But simple things as far as funding mechanism changes, I don't think is a detailed enough document to cause that risk to increase, in my opinion.
And the majority of that is what we've been doing for 7 years.
And I understand that, and that's right. And I think we could easily explain that, and that's why I'm saying if the commission would meet with us, and that's why I asked.
Well, if this board would like, if this council would like representatives to go to that meeting tomorrow, I'm certainly willing to go and ask. I don't necessarily want to go be in the firing zone.
I'll go with you.
But I do, it's that important that if, you know, what time is their meeting? 5, 6? They meet in the afternoons, do they not? 6, okay.
Yeah, 6.
It is important. I mean, I'll be glad to go if that's what you all would like to do, and Wes can go with me.
I would like to go too. I mean, I would, you know.
Whatever.
I want you to go. Then come back. You said you'll go.
Well, we can both go. That doesn't constitute quorum. I mean, the both of us can go.
And I'm just saying,
and go and represent the city council. You know, it's like, this is the message from the council.
Do you think that it will be?
Well, I mean, we take the letter with us and say, why don't you join with us in this letter? I think that if they would be willing to.
But let me ask you this, Julie. Now, do you think that when we do that, do you think that that is going to throw fuel on the fire? Frank, what do you think? Because you look like you're thinking about something over there.
It's hard to say.
I don't know, but all I do know is.
And I'm not saying me go by myself. I mean, what I'm just saying is.
Does anybody need to go? Because he's already said it's going to be, they're going to discuss it tomorrow.
And I think maybe we contact some commissioners and say, hey, make sure that you are talking about this, and what is your temperature? Maybe we can have a consensus amongst us already to say, okay, hey, listen, I've talked to, Frankie Bucks, your guy, Melissa Donnie, or you know, maybe Grady or Robert Setters, Julie, and Jack, I'm not sure who we could talk to. Because I'm running out of names, so, Stalnaker, I guess we can talk to Stalnaker.
But, well, I say that to say to this, to the council, that it's that important to me that we do whatever we need to do so that we are in compliance, we are doing it actively, you know, and again, if it means going to their meeting tomorrow night and making a plea.
What do we really think, I mean, how many times?
I mean, what does it hurt?
If we've said, well, because we just.
I know, so I'll do whatever, y'all say no, you don't need to go, then I won't go.
Do we think you're gonna get a different answer from what we got before?
Probably not.
So, what is the purpose of going other than, well, we tried.
Well, let's just go this time for the last try.
Well, let me ask you this.
That Rob, I think, was fixing it.
I was gonna just make a suggestion, you know, if you decide to go to, and the county is willing to meet, I think that'd be a great thing. However, I think it would be even better if we could get some communication from DCA and some direction from DCA so that when we get to a meeting, we're not faced with this roadblock that this is the only thing we can do. Because time is of the essence, and you know, certainly we can, you know, we craft the letter any way you all want it, but I do hope that we could get DCA to give us the appropriate direction for both to the city and the county so that we know what our options are and we're not limited just to submitting forms that we know aren't true. And that way, when we do meet, we don't have that roadblock to conversations. We know that this option is available. And as Mr. West had said, certainly the best option is to go ahead and complete Form 2s accurately, you know, truthfully, and get your service delivery strategy submitted, you know, and that can be done if everybody can get together, cooperate, and agree on even on a temporary basis.
Would it be helpful, I don't know, again, I'm just sort of grabbing at straws trying to find a solution here. Could our legislators have any impact upon a conversation with the commissioner?
I don't know that.
I asked Pete to contact him a month ago.
Okay.
I'd go from the governor, at least let the three representatives in the Senate know, so when this thing continues to blow up, well, I didn't know anything about it.
Well, no, we have appealed to our legislators in the past that this whole service delivery thing needs to be looked at because they've set us up for.
Oh, yeah, but we care what DCA is doing, so they can't deny knowledge.
It may be worth sending the executive director of GMA a note tonight to say, first thing in the morning, on your behalf, is there any way he could call the commissioner?
And open that door for us to.
And by that time, the letter could be in the email. We set a date, I mean, a time tomorrow before lunch. If Larry could make that happen for us, I think.
He's on the DCA board. So that's a good.
Who is that?
Larry Hansen is on the Department of Community Affairs Board of Directors.
Can I ask a question for the council? You know, what, if you put yourself in this commissioner's seat for a second, and if you received this letter, how would you feel? Because basically it's telling it, your people are telling to sign untruths.
That's what they did.
I understand that. But then we asked them at the very end, oh, help us get back with the county.
No.
Yes, it does.
To do something that's not.
What I'm saying
that's
is.
That's not their role to just to
it does,
be able to dispute between the city and county. Their role
and
is
so what
to
I'm
help
saying
us
is why can't we, and if we don't get any response.
With the deadline dates for service delivery.
If we don't get any response from the county, then you send any letter that you got to or whatever.
What kind of response will we get from the county? I mean,
what if tomorrow they say, okay, we'll meet with you on the 11th. And then we send this, and then DCA gets it, and they say, you know what, whatever you send.
And I'm not calling for a vote. I'm just asking. Do you
want
Wes and I to go?
I want the letter to go, and I'm tired of going, keep going to the county time and time again. Hadn't done a thing.
Yeah,
they're going to sign something that's not true. Send a dang letter to DCA and call them out on it.
All right, let me throw something out. Let me throw this out. Let's get the letter.
Burn the hell out.
Hold on.
It is.
Needs to be.
Let me have a.
No, you don't.
Let's get the letter.
Monster.
To DCA. Let me call Mr. Hansen tonight and see if he can't, again, open that door for a potential. By what I'd love is an audience with the commissioner to address these issues. I will invite Chairman Thompson to go with me at any point in time, and we will go to Atlanta, and we will sit down with the commissioner and see if we can't hand walk this through. That's what we can work on tonight. I can ask Larry Hansen if he'll facilitate that. Tomorrow night at their meeting, let's you and I go, Wes. I think we go as a sign of good faith. One more time, I think we go as a sign of commitment that we are committed to doing what is right per the law. We are asking, we share with them that we are asking DCA to give exception to their normal protocol because it's that important to this community. And let's see if we can join forces in that. We'll see if we can't tie down a meeting date where we can meet jointly. By the meeting date, hopefully we will have heard back from DCA regarding this letter in a potential meeting time. Hopefully we'll have met. So if that seems to be a reasonable expectation of what will happen over the course of the next 48 hours, 24 hours really, then that's, if y'all are okay with that, that's what we'll pursue.
I'm okay with the letter. I'm not okay with you going to the meeting. It's going to backfire. Nothing's going to come of it. But
I think Rob is right. I think we need to know something from the DCA before we have a meeting with the county.
Okay.
So, I mean, we need to know exactly what the DCA suggests, what can be done.
Okay.
And then we have something to put on.
Well, then are y'all okay with, let's go ahead and get this letter prepared and up to DCA via email and fax and everything else. I will still call Mr. Hansen and ask for an audience with the chairman.
I go through him or let him know about it.
And, you know, to see if Chairman Thompson and I, and certainly if Mayor Beasley and Mayor Hunt would like to join in on that conversation, although they probably would not, but they could certainly be invited.
I'd also let our legislative delegation know now, too, when things stand with DCA.
I can do that as well.
They can also, on their end, put their own pressure on it.
So if you feel like that's an appropriate course of action for the very short term, that's easily accomplished. So
who's going to sign this letter?
Mr. Welch.
That would come from the attorney.
Okay. My signature will not be on it.
No, your signature will not be on it.
That's right.
So is that fair? Does that sound reasonable? Rob, do you see any imperfections in that potential plan with regard to any legal issues or?
I don't. As I said, I think that the process that we're discussing is the best hope that we can meet with the county and get a correct service delivery strategy in a timely manner to get this thing done.
All right. What is it, Wes?
I just feel like this is an overreaction until we hear something back from the county about meeting. I don't think we need to go back and point fingers at DCA.
We'll know tomorrow.
Because I know that they are they're a state agency.
Sure they are.
They fund a ton of money. They get a lot of money out. And we do several CBDG grants for city, for other things and everything. And I don't want them to put us, blackball us or whatever the terminology is or whatever. I think that they feel like that they've tried to bend their rules for us to get this project done because they are they're in favor of it. So obviously, kind of like I said at the commission meeting, if they are extremely in favor of this project, then they'll burn a little midnight oil as well. And I know we've already done a little bit of it, and we're going to continue to do more. But that's just the way I feel.
Okay. Duly noted.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other comments? I want everyone to be able to have your say and because your opinion, I mean you're elected officials, you're elected to make difficult decisions or we are all elected to make difficult decisions and challenges and work through these things. So I want to make sure that everyone has the opportunity to speak their mind and feel good about how we're moving forward. Or as good as you possibly can. Lynn Lovett made the comment. Now I'm going to get emotional. Sorry. This is the challenge of having a female mayor. She made the comment today that she's stepping out on a leap of faith. She told me that when Pete and I met with her the other day. And I cannot let that go unanswered. And I think that's what we've got to do too. I think we've got to step out on a leap of faith. I think we've got the best legal counsel that we can possibly procure with Andy Welch. He is a specialist when it comes to working through issues of service delivery. He's well respected around the state. We have a project that you have given so much time to, Wes, and I appreciate that. And it's an important project for this community. And none of us dispute that. And I know we are all at our wits' end with this thing. I think we have gotten into some real deep water with this, but that's what we're charged to do. And I know that this council works from a pure motive. I know that there's no hidden agenda, there's no secret workings going on to try to make anybody look bad, and I guess that's why it was so frustrating to pick up the paper Sunday and read those accusations when I know that those aren't true, because I know each one of you and I know where you come from. And I know you take this job very seriously, as do I. And it's sort of like being in battle together. But we've got the best legal counsel, we've got the best city manager, we've got all the components to make wise decisions for this community, and that's what we are going to do. So, that being said, forgive my little meltdown here, but it's that important to all of us, and I know it's that important to our community. So, I don't like being used as a pawn, and I don't like the insinuation that something is not going to happen because of our actions, because that has not been determined yet. All right, I'm off my soapbox. Any other comments, questions, concerns?
Yeah, I'd like to let the community know it's not the city versus the county.
It's not.
It's really, DCA has come from a front of the commission of some things, and we're trying to get some clarification from them and work with them. It's not like we're opposing the county on anything at all. It's just we're trying to work with DCA and trying to work with the county.
There's not a winner and a loser.
And the county said, DCA said to do this.
Right.
We disagree with what DCA said.
Exactly.
That's who our disagreement is. You said to do this, and we can't do that, DCA.
Right.
All right, so send a letter. I'll call Larry Hansen tonight. Wes, you and I have a date tomorrow night for the county commission meeting.
Yes.
So are the other two in favor? But I don't know. If they want to say yes, it's fine. I'd
like to go to the commission.
I don't have any problem.
Okay, I'd like to go. I think we need to go. And ask Doug Smith. I'll kind of do what I want to do most of the time.
I'm just,
but,
I, you know.
Okay, all right. I'm going to call Larry Hansen this evening. You know, if you feel the need to reach out to our friends on the commission, I'll leave that in your capable hands. I know you'll make the right decisions to call who you need to call or to not call. If you don't want to, that's up to you. I will reach out to our legislators to have a discussion with them to ask for their assistance. And who else do I need to call? Is there anybody else? And I will offer to Chairman Thompson, if he'd like to jump in the car with me and let's go to Atlanta and hand deliver the package, we can do that.
What do we do with these?
I'm going to give mine back to Pete. These are just, this is what, you isn't this what y'all worked on? Isn't this final product?
No.
Now, feel free to keep those.
No, I was like, where did these come from?
Oh, okay. I thought this was your final product.
No.
Okay.
There will be some, there's things such as library. I know you all have discussed mosquito. Whether or not those things, the council agreement to change those things pursuant to the discussions you already had in committee,
right.
We can go ahead and make those changes. But I think, I think that there may be some things there that could be put off. But, Wes, we talk about what I think is, DMA, E911, fire. Those are things that are significant.
Easy funding mechanisms.
Easy.
Yeah.
Development support services. Those are things that really need to be addressed.
Yeah.
Some of the other things
have to change before
we
give anybody.
Well,
these aren't the final drafts, is it? That's not, because I don't remember talking about some of these.
Well, that's what I'm wondering. Street maintenance still gives me heartburn.
But you don't have to formulate a form two if nothing's changing from the 08 agreement. Only things that you would formulate a form two on is the services that you plan on changing. So anything that stays
that
the same,
stuff.
Yeah, you don't have to submit that.
Are you just submitting that, giving this to us to just look at?
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
You're not giving them to anybody.
That's just for your
right.
review.
Right, at this point in time, what I would like to see is, I think that's as close as I could get to what our current strategy is,
uh-huh.
and what we're currently
right.
doing. And this would, it's a good foundation if it needs to be tweaked a little bit here or there, either because of what has already been agreed on between the Service and Liberty Committee, or because maybe I might have got something wrong someplace.
Okay. Well, as if we haven't had enough fun this evening, we do need to go into executive session.
So moved.
For real estate purposes.
So moved.
All right, is there a second?
Second,
all right, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right, we'll take a 47-second break and then we'll come back. Did somebody order pizza?